What's up, everybody? Welcome back. In this video, we're going to jump right into using Webpack to minify our CSS, compile SASS and ES6 code, and for linting purposes. So let's begin. Alright, so first thing I'm going to do is create a blank project. Essentially, this will be a directory that contains an index.html file, some default markup, and a blank app.js file. And if we view this in the browser, you'll see that our HTML file is being read. So let's say that we want to import some CSS into our index.html file. As you see, we have some beautiful H1 text here, but we want to make this even more beautiful, therefore we're going to need some CSS. But before we do anything, let's add a Webpack config file. Create a new file via Sublime Text, Finder, or your terminal, and call it webpack.config.js. Once you have this config file created, insert a module object with an exports property so that we can ensure Webpack is able to read our configuration, and then set it to an empty object, and then save it. Now recall in the last course, in order for Webpack to work off the config file, we first need to specify an entry point. And we'll call this app.js. And then finally we need an output point. Now the output property takes an object as its value, so we have to create an empty object. And once we have an empty object, we can add the output property called filename, and give this filename property a value of build.js, and this is the spot that we want app.js to be compiled to. So finally, let's add a watch property to this, and we're going to set this watch property to true. Now if we type Webpack into our terminal, Webpack will watch for changes within app.js, and output those changes into build.js. So back to importing CSS to make our hello world text prettier. Typically, in order to add CSS to our site, we'd add a link tag within the head of our HTML file, and reference a style sheet from there. So let's start off with this and make our background red. Create a style.css file within your project directory. Select the body tag within your CSS file, and then give it a background of red. Save the file, and then view it in the browser. So as you see, we've successfully changed our background color to red. And this way of implementing CSS is just fine. Using the link tag is okay right now, and that's just because we have so little code within our style.css. But once you start adding a lot of CSS, your file size will begin to grow correspondingly. And as a result, it's nice to minify your CSS in order to ensure that your file is as small as possible, while still giving the browser something it can understand. So let's add a little more code to our style.css file, and give our h1 tag a sans serif font for the time being. Now in order to minify our CSS with Webpack, we're going to do something a little different than importing a style sheet directly within our HTML. We're actually going to delete this link within our style sheet, and we're going to require our CSS within our app.js file. But a quick disclaimer before we do this, Webpack can only handle JavaScript out of the box. It can't do anything with CSS until we download some external packages. So we need to download two external modules. Number one, a CSS-loader module, and number two, a style-loader module. So let's cancel our Webpack watch for the time being, and let's type in the following to install our modules. npm install css-loader style-loader. And then run it, and that should install both the CSS loader and the style loader modules for us. Now, the concept of a loader can be a little hard to understand at first, but you can think of it as an add-on for Webpack. We can plug it into Webpack and it'll take care of specific tasks for us automatically. In this instance, we downloaded a CSS and style loader, which will allow us to require and minify CSS files using Webpack. So now that we have our loaders downloaded, let's go ahead and plug them into Webpack. In order to do this, we're going to head on over to our config file and we're going to add a property called module. Assign an empty object to this property and we'll add another property within it called loaders. And then for this one, we're going to assign it an empty array. So this loaders property takes an array of objects, and each object will represent an add-on we'd like to plug into Webpack. So the first thing we need to do is specify which files we'd like this add-on to run through. We wouldn't want our CSS loader running through our JavaScript files because that's not what it was built for. We need to specify that we only want our CSS loader to run in our CSS files. So in order to do this, we're going to tell Webpack that it should test for a specific file type by adding a test property, and the value for this is going to be a regular expression. So in order to write a regular expression for .css, we start off with a forward slash, which serves as a start point for the term we'd like to find. Next, we're going to add a backslash, a period, and then the file type we'd like to search for, so CSS. Normally, a period without a backslash refers to a pattern that searches for all characters, rather than searching for a literal period. This backslash is used for escaping. We're telling Webpack to search for a file that contains a literal period, followed by the string CSS. Finally, we can end our regular expression by adding a dollar sign and another forward slash. So now that Webpack is testing for all CSS files within our project directory, we can now tell it what loaders we want ran on those files. So since we want to make use of our style and CSS loaders, we're going to indicate that by adding the property called loader. And we're going to give this property a value of what loaders we want ran on our CSS file. So we're going to give it a value of style exclamation point CSS. So the exclamation mark may look a little foreign to you, but all it means is that first we're running our files through a CSS loader, and this is so Webpack can process all of our CSS. And then we're immediately running it through a style loader, so Webpack can apply the necessary styles to our HTML where needed. And one quick thing to keep in mind is that when chaining loaders like this, they are always applied from right to left. Swapping the order of them will cause things to break, so be aware. If your loaders aren't working as expected, they may be in the incorrect order. Alrighty, so let's save our config file and run Webpack in order to ensure everything is working as expected. Looks like we're good to go, so let's head on over to app.js and import our CSS. To import our CSS, it's really quite simple. All we're going to need to do is use require and insert the name of the file we want Webpack to use. In this case, it's going to be style.css. So now if you refresh our browser, you'll see that we have our CSS being loaded once again. And if we inspect our page and open up the head tag, you'll see that our styles aren't being linked via a link tag. They're actually being inlined, which is typically good for page speed. So you'll notice, although our styles are being pulled in, they're not being minified like we wanted them to be. Well, in order to do this, we need to add the -p option, similar to like we did when we were minifying our JavaScript. So if we add this into terminal, webpack-p, run that, and refresh the page once it's done compiling, you'll see that all of our CSS is now compressed and all of our white space has been removed. So really awesome stuff. Now, what if we wanted to use SCSS over CSS? In order to do this, we'll need to plug in another loader into Webpack. So if we type in Webpack SASS into Google and click the first result, we are greeted with a SASS Webpack loader. And this is a loader that will be used to compile our SCSS or SASS into something the browser can understand. So let's scroll down a bit, copy the install string, and paste it into your terminal and run that. So once it's installed, let's head back over to our Webpack config file. Adding this loader is quite simple. Rather than testing for CSS files, we're going to test for SCSS files instead. So we're going to change that here. Then we're going to chain one more loader in front of our style and CSS loaders, and this one is going to be a SASS loader. So let's change the extension of our CSS file to SCSS. Then we're going to require an SCSS file within app.js, and then we're going to run Webpack. And if Webpack runs successfully, you should now be able to make use of SASS and all of its features throughout your code. And we can test this real quick by nesting our h1 within our body tag. And you'll see that Webpack is still compiling our file while the browser is still understanding what we present to it. So a really easy setup in regards to adding SASS support to our project. Now we have our CSS optimized and ready to go, but what if we want to enhance our JavaScript by making use of ES6 code? Well, lucky for us, there's a Webpack loader for that as well. In order to set up Webpack to make use of ES6 code, first off, we need an ES6 compiler. The most popular one is called Babel, so simply search Webpack Babel and click the first result. We're going to scroll down a bit and we're going to come across another installation string. So copy it and paste it into your terminal. So once that's done installing, let's head back to our Webpack config file. And since ES6 is a version of JavaScript, we want to have Webpack run our ES6 compiler only on our JavaScript files, rather than our CSS files or something else. So we'll need to add a new loader object to our loader array and set it to test for all files with extension .js. The loader we want to run our JS files through is called Babel, so we'll specify that now. And then we're going to do something new. We're going to add a property called exclude and specify that we don't want this loader to be run on any JavaScript files within our node modules directory since we're not editing them directly. And then finally, we want to add a property called query, which takes an object as its value. And within query, we add a property called presets. And we're going to set this property to an array that contains the string ES2015. So think of the query property as an options property. All we're saying here is that we want Webpack to compile our code into ES2015 format, which is something that all modern browsers can understand. So with this in place, we can save the config file, run Webpack, and if everything is good to go, we should now be able to use ES6 code within our JS files. So let's test this out now. I'm going to head on over to app.js, and I'm going to declare what's known as a constant. And a constant is currently only available within ES6. So next up, I'm going to console log this out in order to ensure that the browser can understand this constant that we declared. And if I go to the browser, refresh the page, you'll see that it does indeed understand the constant statement. All right, so our configuration is looking pretty damn sweet so far, but let's cover one more thing, linting. If you're unfamiliar with it, the term linting basically means analyzing your code for errors. And as it turns out, computers are a lot better at spotting things that'll break our code, such as missing semicolons, apostrophes, or commas, than us humans are. So it's very useful to have linting programmers to check for these errors automatically whenever a file is saved. So let's make use of the JavaScript linter called JSHint. And to install this, we're going to head on over to terminal like before, and we're going to type in npm install jshint-loader. Space JSHint. And to make use of this loader, rather than to pipe it onto the end of our JS loader, we need to create a whole new type of module called a preloader. And if you guess it, preloaders are simply loaders that are run before all other loaders are called upon. So type in Webpack JSHint into Google, click the first result, and scroll down until you get to the usage section right here. You already know how the test, exclude, and loader properties work, so all we need to do is copy this chunk of code, paste it before our loaders property in our config file, and make sure you add a comma to the end of your array. So with this in place, we should now be able to run Webpack. And you'll see that we're returned with a warning message, meaning JSHint is doing its duties right now and checking for code errors. So if I were to add some random semicolons throughout my app.js file and save the file, you'll see that JSHint has picked up on this, and it's letting us know the issue that it found. And this will be very handy down the road. I can't tell you how many times I've missed a semicolon by accident, and I had no idea why my code was broken, and it just ended up being a simple thing such as that. So all in all, with the addition of loaders, we can add functionality onto Webpack very easily, making an awesome tool for optimizing your code, allowing for the use of next level languages such as SASS and ES6, and for preventing errors with linting. Alright everyone, so this pretty much clears up our course on Webpack. In the next video, I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to take you step by step in regards to how to create a real world product from scratch. And the first thing we're going to develop is we're going to develop a newsletter signup form using Node.js, and we're also going to integrate this with the MailChimp API. So we've got some pretty cool stuff going on in the back end. And front end wise, we're going to make use of our GreenSock animation platform to make this a newsletter signup form that no one's ever seen before. And I don't really want to spoil too much, guys, so if you're interested in this, definitely head on the next video, and I'll take you from there. But in the meantime, I hope you guys have a really great day, and I'll see you then. We'll